land of luxury yachts and expensive sports cars plays host to the climax of EPT 8.
Tournament of Champions.
Tournament of Champions.
Tournament of Champions.
In a 6-max turbo, there's nowhere to hide. The action will be fast.
Proven field.
It's going to be tough.
The prestige of defeating a field of the highest pedigree is second to none.
Best of the best.
Some of the best players in the world.
Only one can be crowned champion of champions here at the PokerStars and Monte Carlo Casino EPT Grand Final. Casino Grand Madrid played host to the inaugural Tournament of Champions. Title holders spanning 7 seasons battle for their share of a €100,000 prize pool. The second ever female EPT champion Sandra Noyox fell just short of the prizes. And in the end, American pro Jason Mercier persevered to take home the top prize and the bragging rights.
It'd be pretty cool if I could win back to back.
That was then. This is now. We conclude Season 8 with another opportunity for Poker's Elite to claim the title Best of the Best.
Every time you get to your table, you feel like it's the final table already.
41 EPT champions covering 8 seasons will take their seats, hungry for a slice of that €100,000 prize pool.
There's still a big rivalry between all the EPT champions because, of course, no one's won 2 yet, so we're all dying to be the first.
35 players will leave empty-handed, but the first prize of €35,000 in live event credits is quite a return on an investment of zilch.
It's a good free roll, 100K, and some good players. So just sit back and enjoy it.
We end this 10-day festival as we began it, with a small, select field. Headlining our TV table is a man who's had another stellar year on the tour. Elky needs little introduction. Mr. PCA has won almost every title out there. So taking this down would certainly be the icing on the cake.
It's like really prestigious and glorious title, especially since nobody has ever won 2 EPTs yet, so I definitely hope I can win it, yeah.
Standing in the formidable Frenchman's way is our reigning champion of champions, EPT4 San Remo winner Jason Mercier. The turbo element of this tournament will make his title defense no easy task.
Playing for, it's more pride, but it's just for fun.
Undertaking a unique challenge is our first ever lady champion, Victoria Curran. In season 3, she went the distance at her hometown leg, but faces another test of endurance here in Monaco. She has a multi-tabling marathon to run.
It's slightly tricky because I'm still at the ladies' event from yesterday, so I might be doing a bit of running between tables.
This season alone has seen 13 stars emerge victorious. Will momentum be an advantage for the likes of Prague winner Martin Finger and Loutraki champ Zimnan Ziyad? Or will it be the consistent EPT6 Berlin victor Kevin McPhee who can outlast the rest to raise that trophy and claim one of the most prestigious brags in the game?
Prestigious brag is better than a sick brag. In fact, it's one of the highest levels of brag.
Important to point out, this is a one-day event. It's a turbo, it's a free roll, so don't expect anyone to hang about.
Hey, Martin, did you get free hotel for part of this?
Yeah.
Yeah, everybody from this season, right?
Yeah, but just 2 days.
Just 2 days for yeah. Champion of Champions?
Yeah. And €2,000 in cash.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, sick.
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 So sick.
Sick. Sick.
Well, now I feel dumb for not winning one. I should have tried harder.
I mean, we've already sat late in, why bother?
Free hotel room in Monaco, that's plus EV. I don't want to say Monaco's expensive, but the minibar requires a credit check.
So in this tournament, we're playing six-handed. These are the 6 characters at our feature table. Everyone starts with 100,000 chips. Not too much movement during the first few hands. Blinds are currently 200, 400 with a 50 ante.
850?
Go get him, Zach Morris.
Kevin McPhee makes it 850 to play. Called by Martin Finger on the button.
David Van Plu in the big blind. Cool as well. All solid starting hands. Wow, all hearts. Second nut flush for Martin Finger. Total whiff for Van Plu. Kevin McPhee was the pre-flop aggressor.
Nice rainbow bet, 16 and a quarter.
And with his pair of fives, he will bet 1,625. See, that's a nice attempt. His pair of flush draw might be good enough to win this now. Sometimes, often he can win it with a double barrel, except this time, nope. Martin Finger called, David Van Plu folded.
3,400.
Second barrel from McPhee. Undercard not helping him at all. Really tough to put your opponent on flopping a flush. Martin Finger raises, makes it a total of 10,300. Remember how I said it's really tough to put your opponent on a flop flush? Well, it's less tough when they raise. Martin Finger wins that pot. Nice read by Kevin. Finger played it super strong, made it tough to get himself paid. I'm sorry, I really shouldn't go around pointing fingers. I've got a horrible feeling that's the first of many. Ding. Vicky Corrin looking for her seat in the Tournament of Champions. She's currently on a 15-minute break in the ladies' event. Poor Vicky, there's only like three tables in this tournament. England against Wales here. Zimnan Ziyad and Roberto Romanello. Zimnan betting the turn, 5,200. Here's the latest craze in side action, Octung. It's kind of like Tron. I've seen these guys play for hundreds of dollars per game, but would it kill you to pay attention to this hand? Like Tron, only way less cool, and that's saying something. Romanello makes the call. Zimnan bet this turn, which was a brick, usually meaning Roberto can call with a pretty wide range. Another deuce on the river. Roberto checks again. Zimnan doesn't seem to mind that the river is yet another brick. He bets 12,700. Roberto now check raises to 30,000. The raise is more polarizing than Team Edward versus Team Jacob. It's either a monster or a monster bluff. Ziyad calls. Roberto shows kings.
And a new trick for me.
For me, yeah.
What trick is that? Calling with the worst of it? Roberto Romanello already building a stack early doors. Back to the feature table. Blinds are up to 300, 600. And David Van Plu has raised the button with Queen 9 off.
42.
That's a 3-bet from Kevin McPhee with the ace 3. Good spot for a re-raise. Suited aces are pretty strong, and you know, it's David's button range is supposed to be pretty wide. But David knows, Kevin knows his button range is supposed to be wide. Oh, you're blowing my mind. A 4-bet from Van Plu to just over 10K. Yeah, we'll just wait. Now Kevin knows that David knows that Kevin knows his button range is supposed to be wide.
19,800.
My brain has officially melted. You have no mind left to blow. Van Plu finally folds.
I'm not sure why I did that. Kind of, eh.
Why not? Seemed like a good spot for you to 3-bet.
I don't know. I felt like I was not paying enough attention to my hand when it opened. And then you might have seen that, so then I just 4-bet you.
Given Kevin's history on this show, you gotta wonder if it would have all gone in after the 5-bet. Good to see he and Vanessa getting along again after Berlin.
I actually think it was a pretty interesting hand, but she was playing pretty absurd.
Was that on TV?
Yeah, it was on TV. She's gonna be cursing me out on television during that broadcast. So.
She will indeed. The German leg of this year's tour provided one of the season's most controversial moments. Close friends turned on one another. Vanessa Selp 6-bet all in with pocket fours pre-flop.
Molly.
Kevin McPhee then tanked for 10 minutes.
Title defense. 2 years later, I call.
You have ace jack?
No.
I have a pair.
I have ace nine.
As the cards hit the table, emotions were running high. The board was kind to Kevin's overcards, and he won a huge pot, leaving his close friend reeling.
Like, it's one of those things, like, I want to win a second EPT, she wants to win an EPT. So when you combine the fact that winning for both of us is so important, kind of makes like a hand like this an inevitability.
He goes after me every time, like, why does he do that?
I guess I got, you know, really heated about it and upset about it, and so I definitely regret, like, the way I reacted to him at the table. It, you know, wasn't appropriate, but I guess sometimes your emotions just get the best of you.
Oh man, that was amazeballs. Pocket fours versus ace nine, all in preflop. Some confrontations are just unavoidable.
Vicky Corrin on her way back to the ladies' event noticed that Vanessa Selps has also made the final table of that tournament.
Yeah, I've played a few hands. It's not relaxing.
Why isn't Vanessa Selps in the TOS? Oh, that's right. She's never won an EPT. Awkward.
I'll check.
Three-way action at the feature table.
Check to Mr. Finger.
Martin Finger, the preflop raiser, called in two spots. Kevin McPhee checking in the dark. And a set of sixes for Martin.
Dream flop for Finger, raising preflop and hitting a set on an ace-high board is like the best spot ever.
Makes it 2,800. Antonio Matias has flop top pair. He calls.
He's got to give action on at least one street. This is just a time to bet and get paid.
McPhee gets out of the way. Another ace on the turn. Now a full house for Finger. Trips for Matias.
Oh, Antonio Matias, if you've been running like this the last few years, it's no surprise we haven't seen you since season two.
It was actually season six when he won Villamora.
Whatever.
He calls another 9,000 from Martin Finger. Jack on the river, pretty irrelevant. Martin Finger bets enough to put Matias all in.
With Matias' stack, there's just no way he can fold, but sometimes A7 is gonna be beat here, and one of those times is now.
Oops.
Sit cooler, bro.
Well, Martin Finger has more than doubled his starting stack and has the early tournament chip lead.
All right, Antonio. Nice playing with you. See you at next year's TOC.
Matias, one of the early casualties.
I figure with a name like Finger, you need, like, the Dr. Evil thing, you know?
Yeah.
Like, 75,000.
Next time.
1 million.
That sounded more like Dr. Strangelove.
Yeah, that did, didn't it?
I hope it falls to him in the big blind so he can say, I can walk!
That's your best joke ever. Kubrick references on the EPT. I'm in heaven. The EPT gets to visit some of the most glamorous locations in Europe. But once a year, we go off-piste and jet across the pond for the PCA. The annual Caribbean Adventure has grown to become one of the most desired titles in poker. New York stock trader John DeBella is our most recent champion, joining the elusive PCA Champs Club. In 2011, US pro Galen Hall burst onto the live scene, taking down the PCA main event. 2010 saw Harrison Gimbel, another young American, outlast a huge field to claim the title. 2009 was Canada's turn when Pori Nazari won a record-breaking $3 million. And in 2008, after 5 days of grueling play, a certain Frenchman emerged victorious. Elke then went on to win the 2009 PCA High Roller event. And he followed that with a further three EPT High Roller titles. So to take down the Tournament of Champions here at the PokerStars and Monte Carlo Casino EPT Grand Final will be a fitting end to yet another successful season for Elke.
Elke's got a lot of titles, but I don't think anything would mean more to him than winning the TOC at the EPTGF.
Well, from Mr. PCA to the reigning PCA main event champion,
cool.
John DeBella calling the all-in of Zimnan Ziyad. Zimnan with the nut straight. DeBella drawing dead with an overpair.
I'm not sure what the action was, but I think that might be a fold with only one pair. John DeBella drawing a dead Bella.
So Zimnan Ziyad will double up.
22-6.
My nut straight brings all the chips to Ziyad, and my hand is better than yours. Come on, you know it.
I take it back. That is the best joke of the season.
Two in one show, all right.
Perfect flop, perfect turn. Just perfect enough for me to call.
Cool story, bro.
DeBella and Ziyad, two players who've won their APT titles during season 8.
Now, either I've never seen this guy before or I gotta quit boozing.
Yes. It wasn't a televised event, and yes, you should quit boozing.
Him I remember. There's a reason his winner interview didn't make the edit. And same deal with this guy. I've never seen him either.
Wasn't on TV.
Phew, thank God. Who's this kid now? I don't recognize him either.
Okay, that's definitely the alcohol, because he won the grand final yesterday.
Doesn't ring a bell.
John DeBella's now all in.
I don't know whether he's trying to trick me or not.
Romanello with the decision.
10K. Wow. Have to dodge two overs and a flush draw.
Have to wonder if DeBell is steaming from that last hand, and have to wonder if Roberto is wondering that as well. Well, that's a comfortable move.
Roberto calls.
I was right.
Good call with one card to come.
I hit my king, though.
I'm sure he'd take a queen or a heart as well. It's the six of clubs on the river. John DeBella doesn't get there, for once.
Nice call.
DeBella had to shove with queen suited there. Nothing you can do. Just have to learn to hit that river.
Romanello, now the chip leader.
My name's Roberto Romanello. I won EPT Prague on season 7. But oh, maybe it's a lucky heart. After day one, it was never going to come off. I started that tournament on a high and I was just flying.
The tears combined with that hat make for an interesting juxtaposition. I didn't know what to feel right there. I'm just kidding, I don't have feelings.
Blinds are now 500 and 1,000. Elke has opened under the gun. He's been 3-bet by Kevin McPhee out of the small blind. Elke makes the call.
This is a pretty loose 3-bet by Kevbo against an under the gun raiser.
Elke flops a set.
Kevin's hit middle pair, which is really bad news for him. That'll be more than enough to continue after 3-betting.
He continues for 6,100.
This is a draw-heavy board, so Elke's hand is going to be pretty well disguised.
Elke just calls. Three of diamonds on the turn. Brings a potential flush.
Turn bricked for a fairly wide range. Only hit flush draws. But the diamond makes it so that Elke can now semi-bluff with his bare diamond too.
Kevin gave up the betting lead. Elke makes it 16,600. Kevin calls.
Now, despite having the losing hand, check calling is probably the only way to play this.
King of hearts on the river. Kevin checks again.
That king is also a huge brick.
25,500.
Elke announces 25,500.
That's a little less than half the pot. Elke's kind of made it clear that he's probably not folding, so I'm not sure if Kevin's thinking of shoving. It's a difficult situation. There's certainly an argument for making this call sometimes, but I think with Elke's line, he's going to have a pair of 8s beat fairly often.
Kevin does call. Elke shows the set.
That's much, much better than my hand.
A six-figure pot for Elke, taking his stack to over 141,000.
What am I thinking? I just call with an 8. Elke always has it.
I have it when you call. If you call, I don't have it. That's a pain.
Classic Elke. Classic. Well, I wouldn't say idiot. I wouldn't go much beyond dummy or dodo head. Maybe as far as chooch, but not idiot. Come on.
Victoria Corrin's multi-tabling mayhem continues as she runs from the ladies' event back to the Tournament of Champions.
I don't think doubling up that's the problem. It's hard getting back and forth across this room.
On one of the other outer tables, it's Vadim Kurzavich against Zimnan Ziyad. Kurzavich has bet 12,000 on the turn.
Jacks are nothing.
You think Zimnan's got a 10? And what is happening here? You think you two could pay attention for once? You're professional poker players.
Ziyad folds.
Interesting little smirk. Wonder if he did have jacks.
He had a jack.
Bah, he had jacks.
What kind of game's going on at this table?
This is the game of kings.
We're playing a game called Octung. It's an iPad game.
Still went the wrong way.
Be quiet.
It's very annoying. I'm playing terribly.
There's no way to pause it. What do you do if the action's on you?
I'll help you.
Tell me if I'm gonna play.
I'll let you know if you got anything.
Yeah.
It's really fun, and I'm destroying her, obviously. Come on, are you serious?
He's folding.
Oh, okay, yeah.
What the hell? I blew that game.
You know, there are other tablet devices available with a wide variety of games.
Once more with feeling. Back to our feature table. David Van Ploo's turn to 3-bet Elke. Once again, Elke opened under the gun with a small pair. Once again, he flats the 3-bet and we go to the flop. This time, Elke does not flop a set, but he is still in front.
Not a great flop for 2-6s. He might be out in front, but he does not have the betting lead.
His check to Van Ploo, who doesn't continue. He checks behind. Board pairs on the turn.
And there's a flush draw out there now. This board still looks really bad for Elke.
He checks a second time.
Elke just wanting to get to showdown as cheaply as possible.
78.
Van Ploo makes a delayed continuation bet of 7,800.
Probably doesn't think Elke would check a pair twice. Certainly not a good one, at least.
Elke calls.
Elke's not beating much other than this exact hand. And when he calls here, I think it narrows his range quite a bit.
Jack of hearts on the river.
It's a 4-card inside straight out there now. All the tens just got there.
Elke checks again.
I think after this check, it's going to be pretty easy for Van Ploo to think Elke's got a small pair here pretty much every time.
That is a bet of 24,000.
And that river card was terrible for a small pair. This bet might be enough to get Elke to fold. He's literally beating nothing but ace-king.
Elke does fold.
Ah, he folded a winner. What a dunk. What a terrible player. Just kidding. Here comes the tweet. More like the Incredible Hulky. You wouldn't like me when I'm tilty.
And after winning that pot, David Van Ploo is back up to 108,800. Just shy of the tournament average.
I'm David Van Ploo. I won Season 7, London. When I look back at it now, I think, how did I manage to do that? I just didn't realise how big a deal it was to make the final, let alone win.
I'm Harry Potter, and I won Season 7 Hogwarts.
Like he's never heard that one before.
I'm sorry, I just couldn't resist. You know, in the bubble burst in a ladies' event, they all just have a good cry and dance around their purses.
And you're single.
Story checks out.
Back to the feature table. Blinds 1,000, 2,000 with a 300 ante.
I didn't want that.
Dealer accidentally exposed the Queen of Hearts. New card.
Michael Tereniak folds under the gun. Elke picks up sevens.
Four. Raise.
Raises to 4,000.
4,000 total.
I would like to wager all of my tournament betting discs.
Kevin McPhee is creatively all in.
And the Queen of
Hearts. Elke's in.
So seek, what the f***?
So sick, you got a queen dead and now you have a king. Pretty sick.
It could have been king-queen suited, though. I prefer the king-queen suited than the ace-king, you know? Against 2-7s. I want the hearts.
I think you're going to feel when the queen's going to come on the board. You would have his queen in trouble.
Queen. How much can I bet on Elke?
Much can you bet on Elke? You can bet everything you want on Elke, dude. I don't know if you're going to find any takers, though.
Elke had been around when Passenger 57 came out. Wesley Snipes would have said, always bet on Elke.
Bink!
What?
What the hell?
So sick, what's going on?
Take it straight, Kevin's gonna win.
I should mention Wesley Snipes is currently in jail for tax evasion.
Wow. I'm like so shocked I can't even be sad.
Good thing you flipped over that queen, because I was for sure shoving king queen suited. For sure.
He was right, he didn't want that queen.
For sure it's. Wow. What? Bro, you saved my life right there, let me tell you. I might have to change my avatar to you after this. Oh, what a flip against Elke! Get on Twitter, when will it end?
Pretty shocked now, yeah. When will it end?
33-7.
Huh?
33-7.
33-7, so much. So sick.
So sick.
Kind of shocked.
Can we get some cocktails up here?
I'm in, you got this, right, James?
To improve your poker skills, check out our poker tutorial shows at PokerStars.com. Welcome back to the Tournament of Champions at the PokerStars and Monte Carlo Casino EPT Grand Final. As expected, that revolving door hasn't stopped spinning. EPT 7 Snowfest champion Vladimir Geshkinbaev was in bad shape against Patrick Antonius and never improved. leaving us in 37th place.
Okay. Flush.
It then got messy for Season 1 Vienna winner Pascal Perrault. He got it in with the worst of it in a three-way all-in. Sim Nanziar tripled up. Jason Mercier survived the tangle, but the Frenchman hit the rail in 36th. The EPT2 Belden champ had barely finished stacking his chips before he found himself dominated by a stronger ace and failed to hit his three-outer.
Well played, everybody. It was a short day, didn't go too well. I won a couple hands and lost a couple hands and I'm out.
Next out was our Season 6 Grand Final winner. The flop saw Nicolas Schwyti jump ahead, only for the turn to knock him back down, and the river sealed his fate. He's out in 34th. Our latest casualty was Season 2 Dublin champion Mats Gavatin. German pro Sandra Neux finished him off with quads on the river, sending the Swede out in 33rd. The stress of a turbo structure seems not to worry French pro Arnaud Mertens. He certainly seems to be making himself at home.
Arnaud's got a leg injury. Guess what he was doing? Walking. Pretty boring story. Let's hope he doesn't have to do any racing.
Well, with this structure, he'll be lucky to avoid a race.
James, I sense chicanery, tomfoolery, and shenanigans.
I would do it, but this thing... It's not in the way.
What's going on here?
Shenanigans abound. I think they're talking about throwing that thing. Please do it.
Who carries a ball of aluminium foil in Monaco?
But yeah, you were the scariest player I played against. So there, you get your little shoe thing, you know, looking all scary every hand.
Uh-oh.
Okay. Race
all-in. You missed, Lex.
During an all-in, too.
Trying to go all-in here. Come on.
No way. I keep it now. You kids play in front of another house.
Call.
Meanwhile, Kevin McPhee is racing against David Van Plu.
How confident are you feeling?
I mean, you already won a flip against Elke, so I feel like
you
want to
bet on me again,
out.
Jake? Yeah? Oh, any takers?
I'm
not betting against myself.
If Jake wants I'm to all bet in. On you, how can I win?
Oh, you're all in? It's lucky. Lucky foil.
Yep, the old lucky foil, full of lucky sandwich crusts and a lucky piece of chewed gum.
Boom.
There it is.
Maybe it is lucky. Jack on the flop for McPhee.
Well, at least he got a 10 left. That's the bonus.
Great.
Jake Cody claims to have folded a 10.
Which would make that the case 10?
One outer.
All right, guys.
I think you induced that by asking where his beer was ready for the cheers. You know.
I was getting ready for the cheers. Nice playing with y'all.
Kevin McPhee is done.
Liv, that might have been some of the unluckiest foil that's ever existed. It's one outer foil. Maybe Vamplu's a wizard. That wasn't a Harry Potter joke this time, I swear. Seriously, though, where's Hagrid?
I reshove Vamplu with... Ace Jack, he calls a tens. Jake says he folded a 10. Flop Jack, turn 10. Yay. I'm about ready to cheers too. Oh well. All right, good luck, guys.
What a cute couple. Love Bofi. That's what I call them. Either that or McLiven. Can't believe he hasn't mentioned the childish behavior of his so called friends throwing that foil ball at him. He could have lost an eye.
Is that during his all in then?
So, Liv won that last longer. All three of our women champions are still in. Sandra Neux, who bubbled the TOC last year. And Victoria Corrin, who's still multi-tabling. Back off to the ladies' event. Well, Jason Mercier is all in and at risk, but he does have aces against ace eight, so...
Pretty good shot he doubles up here. Uh-oh. Romello flops a gut shot. Jason paying him now.
7 for the chop.
All right. Get him, guys.
Also, that wouldn't be a chop poker humor.
Boring.
Yeah.
You know who probably found it really boring? Roberto Romanello.
So, the reigning champion of champions survives.
Jason Mercier and I won EPT San Remo in Season 4. I'm here to play the Tournament of Champions. I'm here to defend my title.
Jason won this event last year when it was called the COC. We changed it for obvious reasons. Also, it finished at 5 a.m., so it's a turbo now, too. Thanks a lot, Jason.
Blinds are up, and Anton Wiggs at the table.
You're playing like 70? 75?
About 70.
Yeah.
Facing an opening raise from Elke. And he will call out of the big blind.
Anton Wig, not in great shape.
Well, he's flopped a pair and a straight draw.
Awfully big flop for him.
Checks to the raiser. Elke's ace is still good, but he checks behind.
Oh, weird. That's a pretty cagey check.
Deuce of hearts changes nothing.
Elke's getting tricky with that check. Have to wonder if he was doing that so he could raise this turn, almost like a two-part check raise.
86.
And now Wig leads out for 8,600.
Let's see.
22,200.
There's the raise.
There we go. Now the only issue I have with this is that it still looks really strong. Luckily for Elke, Anton's got a hand he's probably not getting away from. Way too much equity.
Anton calls. There's now more than 60,000 in the middle. Another jack on the river. Wig doesn't make his straight. Check. He checks.
Now's when I check behind, scared of the jack, and get no value. But Elke, on the other hand,
will go for the value shove. All in for 45,500.
Elke's line in this hand has just been strength all around. I think Anton's got a decent shot at getting away from this.
And it looks like Wig is folding.
I think maybe Elke would have done better to three barrel, maybe even try to get it in on the flop. As it stands, the way he played this hand looks super strong.
Elke's still below average in chips. By the way, Elke is still ranked second on the EPT all-time leaderboard with one main event win, a super high roller third place, and three high roller final tables, including a high roller win. And it's Luca Pagano who holds the top spot with his record 20 main event cashes.
He has the top spot and he's never won an EPT. Strong.
Back at the feature table, action's on Jake Cody, 9-10 off.
8,000.
Raising from under the gun to 8,000.
It's a little loosey-goosey under the gun for my liking.
Michael Tureniak has aces on the button.
And now he's going to get a little acey in the facey.
Three
bets to 19,000. Elke's folded. Martin Finger shoves from the big blind with ace-four suited.
Shove seems needlessly aggressive. Maybe he thought he had aces too?
Jake Cody folds. Obviously, Michael Tureniak calls.
I did it again.
You said it, Brittany.
Queen 10 deuce. Not much for Finger.
This flop is finger licking bad.
King.
How about a wheel draw instead?
Always a sweat.
Better than three of clubs.
Martin Finger needs a five to survive. It's a six.
Good game.
Good game.
Good luck, everybody.
Thanks.
Well, Michael Tureniak now has nearly a quarter of a million in chips.
And now that he's out of the tournament, I guess you could say the EPT is giving Monaco the finger. Yeah, you liked that one, didn't you, buddy?
A rare smile from Michael Tureniak as he busts the early tournament chip leader to take the chip lead himself. Out in the field.
My big blind.
Mickey's back.
I might as well have a look at it, mightn't I?
Facing a raise from Mickey Peterson.
All right, good. See you later.
She folds and heads back to the ladies' event.
You can find it by following the trail of empty ice cream tubs. Hurry! Yours is melting and the bachelor's back from commercial.
Looks like Sandra Noyx is all in. Ace 10 against Ronnie Kaiser's deuces.
Poor Sandra might be getting out by a guy who can't even dress himself. Your shirt's on inside, out, and backwards, brah.
It's the end of a long season on tour. I think he's running out of clean clothes.
To be fair, that shirt would have cost 45 euros to get washed here at the hotel.
Sandra gets there. Kaiser counterfeited on the river.
Put that purse down, honey child.
I just saw the nine. And
the nine was also one of your outs.
That's so sick.
Yeah, but it was mostly sick for Ronnie Kaiser. Oh, now she's laughing at him.
So the EPT5 Dortmund champion doubles up.
I played this tournament last year. It's a special tournament because for that tournament, the whole EPT family come together and actually just want to have fun.
Sandra Noyaks moves all in. Sandra finds herself needing to hit to survive.
I think she might be getting ready to float off in her bubble.
I was bubble girl. It was pleasant.
Sandra Nojogs is the bubble.
So hopefully not this time.
I remember when that happened. I couldn't get out of bed for days. It was awful.
Back to the feature table. Blind still 2,000, 4,000. Action has been folded to Anton Wigg. There's Ace Deuce. He raises to 8,000. Ace King for Tereniak.
Another monster for Tereniak. And is there only one shirt store in Sweden?
They are good friends. Maybe they coordinated this morning. So there's been a 3-bet.
I'm all in.
And a 4-bet shove from Elky with 9-10 suited.
It's a turbo. See ya, Anton.
Tereniak snap calls.
Here we go.
These guys are dang near racing.
Oh, that's okay. Twice in a row. Sick. That's okay.
This tournament's a free roll for them. It has a very top-heavy prize structure, so everyone's going to be a little more gambly.
There's a 9 for Elky.
Elky's never lost 2 flips in a row. I won't believe it till I see it.
Queen of spades. That's a good card. Queen of spades.
But it's a king. Tereniak now in front, and Elky looking for a queen 10 or 9 to survive.
What? This can't happen.
The river card. It's a 7. It just happened.
Hey, good luck, guys.
Thanks. I'm just going to fold into the money.
Just like Michael busted everyone, right?
Elky loses 2 flips. Guaranteed that was just a winning lottery ticket he picked up off the floor. Only explanation.
Michael Tereniak now up to 374,000 in chips. And now that Elky's gone, which champion are you rooting for in this tournament? Have your say and tag your tweet, EPT Grand Final. It's the Tournament of Champions at the PokerStars and Monte Carlo Casino EPT Grand Final, marking the end of another successful season of the European Poker Tour. Unfortunately for Elky, his season is now over.
Like, we're all good friends with the players and we all know each other, and also, like, because it's a free world, it's, of course we're like, it's a free world, it's still a bit more fun than usual, yeah, for sure.
Well, if recent events are anything to go by, our remaining champ should avoid the poker wrecking ball that is Michael Tereniak at all costs. Scandi aggro plus premium hands equals relentless stacking of chips.
Michael Tereniak, EPT Copenhagen, Season 7. I came here with Anton Wigg. I think it's pretty fun that both me and Anton won EPT Copenhagen during subsequent seasons.
I always thought Copenhagen was a guy, not a place.
It's definitely a place.
What am I thinking of then?
Are you thinking of Cohagen from Total Recall?
Yep, that's it.
While we're having a clarification session, Quato is not a sovereign Arab state. We're going to sweat with Michael Tereniak on this hand. We're only going to see his hole cards. Action has been folded to Jake Cody. Blinds are 2,500 and 5,000, and Jake raises to 10K.
Well, if we're playing this hand against Jake Cody, I already know we're losing. He's so lucky rabbits carry around one of his feet.
King 10 offsuit is Tereniak's hand. He will defend after the big blind.
Perfectly fine spot to defend, except for the fact that it's against Jake Cody.
The flop is 10, Jack 7. Second pair for Tereniak. He checks.
This is a really easy spot for us to check call. We might have the best hand, we might not.
Jake continues for 10,500.
But by checking, we give him a chance to c-bet all of his air hands. So when we are ahead, we'll win a bigger pot.
Looks like Tereniak will call. Jake looking back at his hand as we go to the turn, which pairs the board, 7 of clubs.
Well, if we were good before, we're still very likely to be good now. Jake shouldn't have too many sevens in his range.
Michael's checked a second time.
20,500.
Jake bets again.
Even though this is starting to get serious, I think this is another spot for a call we can reevaluate on the river.
There's the call. 87,000 in the middle. One card to come. That card is the six of spades.
This is a good river for us in that it's not a bad river for us.
Cherenyak checks a third time. Cody bets a third time. He's emptied the clip. 50,500.
That's a pretty serious bet. And just based on our hand, Jake isn't going to have us beat very often. But based on his betting, we're either beat from jump or he's semi-bluffing and missed maybe. All the obvious flop draws did miss. But I think if he were bluffing, he might have bet a little more. I'm also not sure Jake's triple barreling with air and leaving himself so little behind very often. We're getting a little better than 2.5 to 1. I don't think that's the right price.
Tereniak folds. Cody had ace jack. We were behind all the way.
Very nice fold by us. I think Jake Cody was trying to put up some houses and hotels on his monopolies, aka three streets of value.
We're heading to the outer tables, where we have an all-in. Arno Mattern is the player at risk with ace eight, called by Constant Reichenberg with ace jack. And there's an eight on the river. Mattern gets the double up.
He is still crippled, though. Technically, he has a hurt foot. Wonder if he's been limping in a lot.
Sorry, what was I thinking of?
We've got another all-in.
I gotta give it back to you at least, don't I? Give you the shot.
Romanello v. Mercia again.
Roberto the one trying to pay early this time. Mercia's down to a less than 1 in 4 shot after missing the flop.
But he hits the turn. Mercia doubles up again.
Had no choice.
Everyone's laughing, having a good time. I love that.
Mercia is still short stack though. Heading back to the feature table where the blinds are up to 4,000, 8,000. Jake Cody has shoved and has been looked up by David Vanplu. Kings against ace queen.
Oh.
Well, Vanplu can't go broke here, but he'll be left with less than 9 bigs. Still 1 in 3 times he's gonna win this, but remember, Jake Cody's so lucky, 4-leaf clovers pick him.
Wow, quads!
Boys, at least.
Never one clip.
The turn in river, more unnecessary than the last hour of that last Lord of the Rings movie.
He's straight as well, jeez.
Jake Cody takes it down with 2 pair. Kings and kings, yeah!
Guess what? Jason Mercia's all in again!
Well, if you're gonna be dominated, might as well be the hot German chicken leather.
Well, he's drawing to an unlikely chop on the flop.
No, you can go to this one.
And now he's drawing dead.
Good luck, guys.
Thanks.
We lose the defending champion of champions.
Jason Mercia always looks lost. Which way is America? Is it over there?
Surprised he hasn't asked his Twitter followers for directions.
Well, Liv's tweeting. Average stack ain't much to write home about in this tournament. Kaboom. Paging Vicky Corrin. Vicky Corrin. You know, I actually tweeted that I would splash the prize pool of the ladies' event with a date with me. Several of the ladies tried to punt their stacks immediately.
Looks like Roberto Romanello is all in and his ace eight has run into the ace queen of Zimnan Ziyad. And Roberto will need an eight on the turn or river to survive. Now has a straight draw. An eight or a nine gets him out of jail. But it's a deuce.
Good game, everyone. Good luck.
Good game, Roberto.
R squared plus Z squared equals Z squared plus 125. Tournament minus R squared equals semicolon open parenthesis.
Vicky's back.
We're down to 4. And if anyone wants to bet me whether that tournament finishes before this one, they're welcome to. Oh, but it's all gone good.
And she's all in. Yannick Rang makes the call. Vicky with 2 pair. Yannick Rang with an over pair.
You rang?
What he said. Vicky fills up.
It did.
It's not that annoying, finally.
It's less annoying.
There's a right way to crack aces and a rang way.
Gentlemen, it's been a pleasure. I'm going back to the ladies' event. Have fun. Don't blow too many hands without me.
She knows she can't bring the chips, right?
All right, see you later.
It's kind of like that scene from Mrs. Doubtfire when he has to keep running back and forth between the tables. Come to think of it, they sound kind of similar too. Great movie, by the way.
One of my most hated movies of all time. We'll talk about this later, Stapleton. Ace King for Tyreniac.
You mean we'll fight about it later?
He raises to 24,000.
See if Tyreniac continues to run over this table.
Ace 9 for Vamps.
What you gonna do, Vamplu? He's got about 23 bigs.
All in.
He shoves. Tyreniac calls. And Vamplu will see he is dominated.
Vamplu the 3-1 dog. Very likely to be heading home. To the land of Yuvajanaya Dodefire.
Please stop referencing that film. No help for Vamplu on that flop. He does have a backdoor straight draw. His best hope is to spike a 9. Instead, it's a king.
Vamplu can't win, but he can hit the queen ball for a chop.
The river. Here's another jack. We lose David Vamplu.
Nice hand. Yeah, it's fine.
I appreciate it when they slide the chips over themselves. Sportsmanlike or desperate attempt to touch your chips one last time? You decide.
With Vamplu's elimination, we are down to 12 players. We're down to our last two tables. And Michael Tyreniac is now a monster chip leader with more than 731,000. In fact, he's the only player in the tournament with more than 50 big blinds. Sandra Noyox and Liv Burie also in the top half of the leaderboard. In the bottom half, most of the players have less than 20 big blinds. Yannick Rang, the immediate player at risk, with just a 12 big blind stack. Well, whatever happens, we will have a new champion of champions.
Well, I was obviously hoping to win. It's not that big of a deal that I didn't. We're not playing for big money or anything, but it's more for pride, and we're all defending champions, so it's pretty cool to be named champion of champions, but I couldn't do it 2 times in a row.
Next time, a new champion will be crowned as 12 fight for the final title of Season 8. Will Mohsin Charania be able to take down 2 titles in 2 days? Can Victoria Corrin keep up the pace as she attempts to complete her poker marathon?
This is like Tootsie.
Or is it Jake Cody's turn to run over the competition?
I know the shove fold type of poker quite well, and I think there's definitely a lot of players that make mistakes in these formats, so for sure I think I've got an edge.
Find out what happens as the Tournament of Champions continues.